Our guest today made it possible for a young lady they did not know, living in a foreign country they had not visited, to attain her dream of becoming a lawyer. This is a story of giving to a stranger, and that stranger giving back to a community many miles away. We'll be right back.
Ellos muchas felicidades y que sigan adelante y perseverando en el estudio y en el esfuerzo.
I not speak good English, but I would like to thank everyone. You help me, but I'm lawyer. Thank you for my heart.
Hello, I'm Val Jeffrey of The Better Part. Today's program, Giving and Giving Back, is about a young lady named Lydiette who lives in Nicaragua and her dream of becoming a lawyer. My guests, Jan and Howard Hill, helped make that dream a reality. I made a program with Jan and Howard after they helped rebuild a village in El Salvador after a devastating earthquake. They told me then that they were actually on their way to Nicaragua to visit a girl they had sponsored. It's a very interesting story. This is Lydiette's story. Back with us, our local residents, Jan and Howard Hill. Welcome back to The Better Part.
Thank you, Val.
Thank you, Val.
Now, I really want to start by giving our viewers a feel for Nicaragua. And we've got a little bit of video. So, Howard, would you like to tell us all about it?
Nicaragua is the largest country in Central America. It's about the size of England, has a population of about 5 million, and is situated between Honduras to the north and Costa Rica to the south. These are some views from the island, from the town of Rivas, which is close to where our friend Lydiette lives. This is the local museum showing some of the artifacts, and like most Central American cities, has a large central square with open spaces for people to walk and sit, and the cathedral is to the north of the square. The cathedral was built probably in about 1700, dominates that northern part of the square. Rivas is a town of about 30,000 people, as you can see, still relies on some rather antiquated forms of transportation mixed with the new horse-drawn carriages for transporting goods and people ply the streets all the time. Many people ride bicycles, and there are a few cars. Most of the cars are taxis. People sell their wares out on the street, fruits and vegetables grown locally. The ice cream truck, a common sight in many Central American cities. And plenty of people out buying goods, clothing, shoes, all sorts of merchandise available. Here's deliveries to the local market. As you can see, there are two large lakes in Nicaragua. The southernmost one is about 100 miles long and includes the island of Ometepe, which is where Lydiette lives. It's the largest freshwater island in the world. You can see it's actually formed by two volcanoes. Lydiette lives on the northeastern side of the island in the town of Alta Gracia. And you reach the island from the mainland. The shortest crossing is 1 hour by ferry. So it's about 10 miles or so across. And Lydiette works with an organization called Fundación Entre Volcanes. It's an organization that concerns itself with women's and children's issues and in concern for the environment. This is the building that it works from. And Lydiette is now practicing law out of those offices. It's in the town of Moyogalpa, which is where you land when you arrive on the island, with the volcano in the background. This is a uraca, similar, it's a national bird of Nicaragua, same species as our jay. And The wind fairly constantly blows from the east, so that there's always fresh wind coming across the lake and sometimes large waves.
So Jan, it was a twist of fate that got you involved in this sponsorship program from the beginning. Why don't you tell us about that?
You're right, Val. I had signed up for a particular class in the morning. When I got to the registration, they'd lost my forms. So my first and second choices were already full. And I kind of reluctantly went to the third choice. I really didn't know what I was getting into. And it turned out to be a class run by a group in this area called Capacitar. And as a result of that class, I learned that they were going to take a group of women on a humanitarian mission, solidarity with women in two Central American countries. And one of those countries was Nicaragua.
And is that where you met Lydiette?
Yes, Lydiette was introduced to us as one of the only women guides on the island. We wanted to see the island where she lives. And our guide on the mainland, Sister Julie, got in touch with Lydiette's organization, Fundación Entre Volcanes, which is right here on the t-shirt. And so we met this young woman who looked about 13 years old, who guided us for two beautiful full days on her island. And as a result of that, we learned what a bright young woman she is. At 18 years old she was, not as young as she looked. Graduated from high school with no possibility of going to university to complete her education to further help the people on her island, the women and the youths, both in abused situations. So that's how we met her.
So Howard didn't go on this trip at all, just you went on this trip?
Myself and seven other women.
Right. Yeah. So when you got back, what happened?
I was asked to give a talk at our local church, St. Jude the Apostle Episcopal Church in Cupertino, about the people that we met on the trip and what our impressions were. As a result of that talk, several people came afterwards up to me and to our friends there and said, how can we help this young woman? They really liked her story and wanted to know how to help. So we sent a letter to Sister Julie in Managua, in Nicaragua, asking what would it take to get Lydiette started in law school? How much money each year? How long would it take, etc., etc.? And to our surprise, we got a couple of weeks later, we received a fax back saying, thank you very much, Lydiette has already enrolled in law school. And then it was up to us to raise the money.
So how did you raise the money?
I contacted most of the people who had been interested and told them how much it would take, and everyone agreed. There were at the beginning there were about 14 people that agreed to give a certain amount each year, and we kept doing that for 6 years.
Now at this time Howard still hadn't met Lydiette, right?
That's correct. That's correct.
And you sailed to El Salvador to go and see her. So tell us about that trip.
While our boat was in El Salvador, we took a trip to visit Lydiette from El Salvador down to Nicaragua. That's about a 150, 160 mile trip to Managua. It involves crossing two borders from El Salvador to Honduras and Honduras into Nicaragua. Many of the bridges along the way were actually still under repair and destroyed by Hurricane Mitch, which happened a few years before. This is the bridge crossing from Honduras into Nicaragua. After spending a few days in Managua, we went down to see Lydiette on the island. We took the ferry, 1 hour crossing, to the town of Mayogulpa. Sometimes the water here can be quite rough. And here's where we met Lydiette, where I met Lydiette for the first time. We traveled with another friend who met Lydiette before. So the three of us, Jan, Susan, and I, met Lydiette at this restaurant, where we shared a meal of local fish, and the legend is that if you eat the fish of Omotepe, you will return to the island, and it's certainly been true for us, and we hope it's true again. She took us to her hometown of Alta Gracia, about an hour's ride away. Some of the ancient statues and the church was decorated for the 15 annual celebration. We traveled mostly by truck, provided by the Fundación Antropolcanes. This is a typical way of traveling. Sometimes many more people than this would be in the back of the truck. And you can see some of the reasons it takes a while. The roads are dirt and bumpy. Here we're going to an outdoor presentation that Lydiette had organized. She'd gathered some of the youth leaders from the communities on the island to come to meet, and she'd arranged for a doctor to come and give a presentation. And the subject of the presentation was sexually transmitted diseases. And the idea was that the young people would learn from the doctor and take the message back to their home communities and teach more people. Following the presentation, Lydiette and a friend who spoke pretty good English took us on a tour through the banana plantations, up past the finca where they grow coffee and also offer space for tourists. And they took us to see these petroglyphs. These are ancient carvings on rocks. This is on the slopes of Volcan and to the south of the island. Then we went to see Lydiette's family. We went to her home. We were introduced to her mother and her father. And we shared some food with them. Lydiette tells us her favorite is sandia, watermelon, so she was shared a watermelon with us.
¿Y tú quieres una entera?
En el cuello.
¿Te dejaron tarea?
This is a recycling of the watermelon rind. And here we're sharing some gifts that we have brought. The young girl in the background is a cousin. In fact, there are two cousins were there that day as well. So here we're sharing some family photos. And here's the family all together. Her mother and her father. And Lydiette at this time in the middle of her studies towards becoming a lawyer.
Was there a language barrier?
Yes. Our Spanish is good enough to buy groceries, but not good enough to have decent conversations. So
how did you communicate?
Well, with difficulty and a little bit back and forth. And fortunately, many of the people we met in those countries speak at least better English than we speak Spanish. So between the two, we can communicate. When I first met Lydiette, she didn't speak very much English. She understood more than she could speak. But as we've known her over the years, her English has got better and our Spanish has got better, so our communications have got better.
Did you visit Lydiette again before the graduation?
Yeah, later that year, we sailed from El Salvador down to Nicaragua to the port of San Juan del Sur. We anchored in the bay and got on the water taxi that took us to shore. We had on board a computer, a printer, lots of books and some school supplies that we had brought down from California. And there we met her family again. Lydiette had borrowed a car and a friend to drive it so that we could put the supplies in the car. And it was nice to see them again.
In English.
Lydiette, on the way back, had to go drive to the ferry, put the car on the ferry, and then get the books and the supplies to the school and the office where they were going to be used. That was about another 30 miles from where we were. And so once again, we said a fond farewell.
Bye-bye.
Hasta pronto.
Bye-bye.
How did you know how she was getting on at school?
She would send us regularly reports each semester. I think it was organized on a semester basis. She would send her grades and reports of her classes, so she continued to do that during all of her studies. Yeah. So we knew she was doing well because she got good grades in all her classes.
Yeah. Well, so what was a typical day? Didn't you say she got up at what time in the morning?
She would have to get up about 4 o'clock in the morning, get on a bus or a truck, whatever transportation, to the ferry terminal in Mayagalpa, then catch the early ferry, then another bus to the university campus in Rivas. So it took her about 4 hours to get to where she needed to be by 8 o'clock in the morning. And then, of course, she went home again in the evening, another 4 hours. Sometimes she stayed overnight if there were classes on Sunday.
But did she work at the same time?
She did. She worked full-time for the Fundación, and part of that time she was the director, because the current director had to leave for health reasons. So Lydia took over that responsibility.
Then you received an invitation to the graduation. Tell us about the graduation.
We were pleased to receive an invitation to Lydiette's graduation. At the time, we had sailed our boat to Panama and were living on the boat there. So we were able to travel from Panama City to Rivas by bus, about a 30-hour journey, although quite comfortable on a luxury bus. And then, after spending the night, we went to the graduation ceremony. We decided to take one of the horse-drawn taxis. Here we are riding along down the Central American highway to one of the campus buildings of the university. The university is a fairly new campus of part of the Polytechnic University of Nicaragua. And the ceremony was held in the upper floor of this building, an open-sided, at least, auditorium. And here we met Lydiette and her family, her mother and her aunt. And here they're looking at the display to say that Lydiette was one of two people to receive, to graduate with honors. The graduates coming in to the ceremony, each accompanied by a family member. There were about 35 graduates, half of whom had been attending school on Saturdays and occasional Sundays, as did Lydiette, and the other half attended classes during the week. Whichever program you were in, you still had to take the same number of classes, so the requirements of graduation were the same. It just meant that if you only could go on Saturdays and Sundays, the whole course took 6 years, whereas it could be completed in 4 years with full-time study. Ceremony was the same sorts of formalities that we would have in a U.S. graduation ceremony: the national anthem, school song, and a song for the city of Rivas. And this particular ceremony was the third graduation for the law school. So Lydiette was actually one of the first to attend this university, at least this campus of the university, as a law student.
Porque significa que vamos a tener más personas que van a ser capaces de poder hacer que vivamos no con la ley de la fuerza, sino con la ley del derecho.
So a good many speeches, all in Spanish, of course, so we didn't quite understand everything that was going on. The invocation was perfectly understandable, but some of the later speeches, I'm afraid we didn't pay that much attention to, and I have a feeling that some of the graduates didn't either. And then the formal presentation of the diplomas. Each graduate came up to receive a stole with their name and their certificate of graduation. And besides her graduation diploma, Lydiette received two other awards, one because she graduated with honors, and a second award because she was judged to be the best overall student in her year. She had to study, of course, philosophy of law, history of law, and then studies, specialty studies in civil law, penal law, trade law, and labor law. So now she's qualified to represent the people of her island in those particular areas. She does that and presents cases before the court in Rivas.
Lydia is visiting America, and I want you to meet her. I decided it best to talk with her in the comfort of the Hills home instead of in the studio. Here's that interview.
Hi, I'm Val Jeffrey of The Better Part, and I'm here at the Hills house, and I want to introduce you to two people. I want you to introduce you to Lydiette, who is visiting here from Nicaragua. Welcome to America.
Thank you.
And our interpreter for today is Doris. And Doris, say hello.
Hi. Hello.
We're all very nervous here. This is the first time we've done simultaneous translation. So excuse the laughing in the background. It is a serious matter. Lydia has become a lawyer, and everyone is very, very proud of her. So I'm going to ask her, why did you dream of becoming a lawyer?
¿Cuál fue tu sueño de ser abogado?
Bueno, lo que me llevó a ser abogado fueron las
to be able to help the people in the community, to show them how to empower themselves, especially the youngest and the women.
And when you held up your hand to be sworn in to be a lawyer, how did you feel about it?
Cuando levantaste la mano y juraste, ¿qué fue lo que sentiste?
Me sentí orgullosa de poder haber cumplido uno de mis sueños y sobre todo
it was so much satisfaction and I was so proud to be able to finish and accomplish this my career.
And how does being a lawyer empower the women of Nicaragua?
Al ser abogado, ¿qué es lo que le ayuda para empoderarse a las mujeres de Nicaragua?
Yo creo que una de las cosas que todas soñamos es vivir sin violencia.
To help
es importante que las mujeres conozcan que tenemos derecho a vivir sin ella, sin violencia, y que podemos ser felices.
Well, I want to thank you for talking to me, and I want to say congratulations. What's congratulations in Spanish?
Felicidades.
Felicidades.
Thank you. What else? Thank you.
I just want to say a big thank you, first of all, to Doris for translating. It's not easy translating, so thank you, Doris.
You're welcome.
And I want to say thank you and congratulations one more time to Lydia. She studied for 6 years to become a lawyer, and it's no small feat. So congratulations, Lydia.
Thank you.
Well, we've come to the end of the program. I really enjoyed all the clips that you took, Howard, and you explaining them all to us. And there's just one person missing from our little group. So I'm going to have Lydiette, who's here in the studio, to just come and join us. Come on, Lydiette. It's very, very special to have Lydiette here with us. She's going back to Nicaragua. She's going to help youngsters and women. And it's all because of this community here in Cupertino. To Jan and Howard Hill and everybody that helped Lydia on behalf of The Better Part, thank you for sharing your story.
Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you, Val.
Thank you.
You shall appoint judges and officers in all your towns which the Lord your God gives you, according to your tribe, and they shall judge the people with righteous judgment. You shall not pervert justice, you shall not show partiality, and you shall not take a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and subverts the cause of the righteous. This quotation from Deuteronomy was included on the back of the invitation to the ceremony.
We hope that you've enjoyed this program and will join us again. Got any comments, suggestions, or would you like to be part of our crew? Give us a call. You can reach us at the Cupertino Senior Center, 408-777-3150, or visit our website, www.thebetterpart.com. Thank you for watching.